So here now to react is Ambassador Stuart Holliday, former U.S. Ambassador for Special Political Affairs at the U.N. Sir, thank you for joining us. What was your take?
Thank you. Well, I thought it was pretty consistent with President Trump's rhetoric, but the U.N. isn't really accustomed to that sort of level of, bellicoseness from an American president at the U.N. So, but I did think he laid a marker down. It's very clear the U.N. was created to actually avert war. And if people think of the consequences of a war on the Korean Peninsula, they might try to step up and prevent one from happening.
So you thought it was bellicose? It sounds like you weren't very fond of the speech. It's quite a departure from, say, Ambassador John Bolton, who thought that it was the best speech he's heard Trump do, that it was, he left no stone unturned. He kind of went through and addressed so many of the complaints that everyone around the world has had about the U.N. I mean, for example, putting Saudi Arabia, on the Council for Women's Rights. There are so many outrageous things that go on in the U.N. And normally it seems like people just stand up there and sort of congratulate each other.
No,
and all
right.
they do is rebuke Israel.
No, exactly. I meant this is how it was going to be perceived in the room, not that I didn't think it was a solid speech. I think it was. And I think it was clear, it was very focused, and it really kind of set a bright line between the civilized world, the community of nations, and some of these rogue states that we really need to step up and prevent from getting nuclear weapons.
How odd was it that some of the rogue states were sitting there listening to it? I mean, I was watching the tight camera shot of the representatives, whether it was Iran or, North Korea, hurried an underling out there to listen so there wouldn't be really anyone of note sitting in the audience to listen to this. What did you think of that part?
Well, that's part of the theater of the General Assembly. The North Korean ambassador did leave, but that's happened before, but it's part of the unique nature of the General Assembly where you actually have this sort of spectacle, if you will, the countries watching, looking at the reactions. Obviously, Netanyahu very pleased. Others may be a little bit more concerned, but that's part of the action at the UN.
It seemed like maybe the point was to concern those who are aiding or even appeasing North Korea. I mean, some would say that the remark that's become the headline out of this about, basically wiping North Korea off the map if they don't stop their nuclear program was really aimed at China. Is that possible?
I think so. And let's also be clear, he was talking about taking action on North Korea if our allies, the United States, were continued to be threatened. And that is a very, so it's being taken a little bit out of context. But I do think it's aimed at China. And I think that China is key, as we've said for many years, to, cutting off the spigot that's sustaining the regime. I think they're starting to take it seriously, but there's a little bit more road to go on that for the Chinese.
Yeah. What do you think is the outcome of this? I mean, what do you think the impact is?
Well, he's going to have some bilateral meetings with, he already has, but with the Chinese. And I think it's really going to be sort of setting out a time frame and a framework for them to take more action and to, in effect, try to cripple the North Korean economy. They've been reluctant to do so. But if they hear this kind of language, again, this sort of bright line language, they're going to be concerned. They don't want war on their doorstep either.
And to clarify, as you said about that, but if it is forced to defend itself or its allies, we will have no choice but to totally destroy North
Korea.
Right. You're right to point that out. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ambassador.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.